Okay, good afternoon and welcome to this meeting of the Conveners Group. I've received no apologies. I think we're waiting for a colleague, but I'm sure she'll be along shortly. This meeting is in public and your microphones will be operated automatically. I welcome the First Minister to the Conveners Group. The meeting will be around an hour and a half. We've agreed to focus today on the Scottish Government's programme for government, but inevitably conveners will want to touch on other more general issues, so I will be applying the usual leeway to allow that to happen. Some conveners have indicated they wish to raise more than one issue, and I'll do my best to call all conveners at least once, and in order to get through as much of the business as possible and to allow for those supplementary questions, I would ask for brevity in both questions and responses as far as possible. As with the previous meeting with the First Minister, it would be helpful if we could start with some general issues of interest to the committees before moving on to the more specific ones falling under the programme for government. I therefore start with some questions around transparency and accountability, and I invite Martin Whitfield, Convener of Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. You may be glad to know I only have one question sort of lodged, which means I'll take about 45 minutes over it. I think that was the agreement. My question is in relation, really, as I'm sure you will expect, about the scrutiny that this Parliament can give the Scottish Government, which I know you have indicated in the past that you very much welcome. But in particular, I was going to ask you about the committee system that we operate here, because obviously the committee system is the backbone of the process of holding the government to account, the scrutiny of bills and other items. And it is the intention of my committee to look at some depth into the work of committees, probably principally in relation to bills. And really, it was just to give you an opportunity to firstly put on the record, I hope, your confirmation of agreement of the importance of that element of our system in the Parliament, but also to say whether you have any concerns at the moment about the committee system.
Can I thank Martin Whitfield for the question? Can I thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to be here today? I will also try to keep my answers brief, given, as you may be able to tell, I am battling a very serious case of the man flu as things stand, but I'll do my very best to power through. Can I say, in relation to Martin Whitfield's question, I'm very interested in the work of the committee, very interested. Indeed, our parliament, of course, still a very young parliament. And it's right that its procedures continue to evolve. And in fact, just after the back of summer recess, we know there's been some tightening up of the time taken for questions and answers, for example, so we can get more questions and more scrutiny of the government, which is something I absolutely welcome. So we should, as a parliament, be absolutely open to continual evolution. As a government, we'll cooperate fully with the piece of work from the committee. I think the committee system has absolutely got its strengths. We can see that in terms of how committees around this table have significantly influenced legislation, often ensuring that the government compromises and makes compromises where it can. But I absolutely am open for any discussions, proposals on how that system is improved. So when there are specifics, I can give an absolute guarantee to Martin Whitfield that we'll engage constructively. There may be some recommendations that we agree with, some that we disagree with, but we'll be upfront about that. But I certainly welcome that piece of work from the committee.
I'm grateful.
Thank you. I'm now going to invite Kenneth Gibson, Finance and Public Administration Committee.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. My question is a very straightforward one with regard to budget transparency. At present, during budget debates, members often quote different figures, like apples and oranges, in relation to whether spend has increased or decreased. In the interest of transparency, will the Scottish Government present, alongside the Scottish budget, details of what was actually spent the year before the current year, details of what is being spent in the current year, and what the planned spending will be in the next financial year, so that Parliament can accurately compare this information?
That's a very open to that. I think this is a point that Kenneth Gibson has made on a couple of occasions, and it's I think a very fair challenge to us indeed, and we want to be as transparent as we possibly can. I'm very proud of the decisions we've made in relation to our budget, and particularly in relation to progressive taxation, so I'd be very open to doing what we can to publish that level of detail, because I think Kenneth Gibson's absolutely right. Transparency will absolutely help in relation to some of the arguments that are made around our budget and around taxation.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Edward Mountain, Convener Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, First Minister. Obviously, how we achieve net zero is critical to the remit of the Net Zero Committee. Can you explain how you will show the government's aim to reach their net zero budget in a bill, and when the first bill will be where this is shown in detail so that it aligns with your government's objectives?
So I think, first and foremost, I would say that, of course, we're committed to producing our climate change plan. We have to do that. Of course, the Cabinet Secretary stood up last week on the back of the UK government's announcements that we will have to, that may well have an implication for when we produce that plan, because we have to understand what the impact is of UK government announcements on our own plans, particularly in relation to electric vehicles and phasing out of petrol and diesel cars. So the climate change plan will give some detail of how we intend to meet those targets. In terms of future budgets, of course, in our budget at the end of this year, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance will make it really clear how we intend to invest in our net zero commitments that will help us to achieve our net zero targets.
OK, First Minister, you mentioned the climate change plan, and I'm aware of what the Cabinet Secretary said last week. It was probably the most open secret in this Parliament that it wouldn't be produced by Christmas this year, which was when it was forecasted. So my question to you is, when will it be produced, and will it be produced in time to allow the Climate Change Committee to have full sight of it before they do their annual report to this Parliament?
So it would certainly be the intention to give the Climate Change Committee as much notice as we possibly can. I don't think it was inevitable that it was going to be delayed. It's not my not my reading of the situation. I can see Edward Mountain has a different view of that. But, I mean, in all seriousness, we have to understand the implications, particularly around the phasing out of petrol and diesel vehicles. I think Edward Mountain would accept that if the UK government has a different position, then what does that mean for example, the Internal Markets Act? What does it mean, for example, for those who may purchase a car from down south and therefore but use it in Scotland? What are the implications of that? But what I want to say unequivocally is our position remains that we will not shy back from our own commitments. We're very committed to the various different timetables and milestones that we have to meet our interim targets. I want us to be seen as a climate leader, and I think that's in quite stark contrast to what we saw from the UK government last week. So we have no intentions of rolling back. I think the committee that Edward Mountain chairs does a very good job of holding the Scottish government to account in relation to the fact that we haven't met those targets recently and narrowly missed the last set of targets that came out. So there is a job for all of us to do in ensuring that Scotland continues to show that level of leadership.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And I now to Richard Leonard, Convener of Public Audit Committee.
Thanks, Convener. First Minister, when you attended the Conveners Group in May, you said that you would, and I'll quote you, absolutely commit to reviewing and examining what more the government can do to be as transparent as possible. So can you tell us three things that you've reviewed and examined over the last 4 months?
So I don't have a list of the things that we've examined. One aspect I've asked the Minister for Parliamentary Business to look at and engage with even external stakeholders is how we ensure that we are meeting our obligations to written parliamentary questions and FOIs. I know there's been some considerable external commentary as well as internal commentary in this Parliament around what more we can do in relation to meet those targets around freedom of information requests. So I've asked the Minister for Parliamentary Business to look at that, and there was a serious need for us. There was long-standing FOIs that hadn't been answered and I delegated, in fact, made it a point to discuss in Cabinet how we quickly respond to those outstanding Freedom of Information requests, and also in parliamentary questions. I suppose the third thing, FOI's parliamentary questions, I suppose the third thing was in during the course of the summer, there was a fair bit of understandable media attention on credit card purchases from the Scottish Government. So I asked the Permanent Secretary to look at the processes, and that's still underway. I've had, I think, an initial response back from the Permanent Secretary on his examination of credit card purchases from the Government and how we ensure we're transparent and, of course, that any spend that is being made is appropriate. So those might be three areas, but I'm sure there's certainly more that we have done in the space of the last 4 months, which I'm happy to write to the convener, and that can be passed on to Mr. Leonard.
Last week, the Public Audit Committee took evidence from Transport Scotland on the Barry Smith KC inquiry. In the interest of transparency, will you publish today the terms of reference for that inquiry?
I'll certainly look into if we're able to do that. So I will explore if that is possible to do. I mean, I genuinely believe, particularly on the issue that Richard Leonard raises, we should be as transparent as we possibly can be. So I will certainly look into that and come back to committee if we're able to publish the terms of reference.
Thank you. Thank you, Richard. We now move on to the Verity House Agreement, and I'm going to invite Ariane Burgess, Convener, Local Government, Housing and Planning Committee, to take forward the questions in this section.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister.
Afternoon.
So this is a question around government accountability. The committee welcomes the progress being made toward a new deal with local government as set out in the Verity House Agreement. With this significant devolution of power to local government, how does the First Minister envisage the role of national government changing, and how will Parliament be able to hold the government to account for delivering on shared priorities when so much decision-making will rest with local government?
First Minister.
I think it's an exceptionally important question. I'm really grateful to Ariane Burgess for asking it. So the Verity House Agreement, for me, it was exceptionally important to get over the line in the first 100 days. I think it's safe to say that the relationship between national and local government could be improved, and I'm pleased that the Verity House Agreement is a demonstration of our desire, collective desire, to improve that relationship. And I very much believe in the spheres of government as opposed to the tiers of government, and very much believe in national by exception. I think for me there is a genuine question, which Clause will absolutely accept, around accountability and ensuring that as we loosen, for example, ring fencing, that there's a shared understanding of the outcomes that we each want to achieve, and how are we each held to account for those the achievement of those outcomes. And that's why, having signed the Verity House Agreement, that is the very beginning of the process. There will now be a period of quite a number of months, and actually it may, as we go through it, even take years, to ensure that there is the appropriate mechanisms in place to be able to scrutinise those outcomes. One of the key areas that we're working on with COSLA at the moment is the accountability framework. It's being very much developed in partnership with our friends and colleagues in local government. I fully intend that that accountability framework be shared with Parliament and with bodies that hold local government to account as soon as practical. So that work is very much underway, and I think that that accountability framework will be important so that Parliament can hold national government to account in relation to those outcomes.
Thanks very much.
Thanks, Ariane. And I'm going to move on to Stevenson, Convener, Social Justice and Social Security.
Thanks, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. And still focusing on the Verity House Agreement, particularly in child poverty, and I know that's something that's high on your agenda coming from the last programme for government. So how does the Verity House Agreement affect the Scottish Government's approach to tackling child poverty?
I think ultimately we both have a shared endeavour to tackle child poverty. Certainly in my discussions with COSLA, it is an issue of the highest priority for them, and we're both committed to that. And I think that's where the accountability framework is going to be really important. So we can all talk at very high levels around what we want to do to tackle shared poverty. The member will be very aware of course, the targets that we have set ourselves, very ambitious targets, the four targets around poverty that we have set ourselves as a government. The agreement that we have in place, the Verity House agreement, it very much sets out those principles about how we will collaborate together to tackle poverty, and it's very much central to the Verity House agreement. COSLA and SOLIS, bodies that are SOLIS, I know, are well known to conveners, they're very much represented on our Child Poverty Programme Board as well. So the accountability framework will give, in a very transparent way, detail of the outcomes that we're hoping to achieve, how we can be held to account in relation to that. I can give an absolute assurance to the member that child poverty is a shared endeavour and shared priority between ourselves and local government. It seems that my man flu may have spread to others, which I'm very sorry about.
Okay, Colette, thank you. Okay, we're going to move into some of the broad areas covered by the Programme for Government, and we're going to start in the area of economy, and I call Claire Baker, the convener of Economy and Fair Work Committee. Claire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So today, First Minister, today SNP published their annual accounts, and they recorded losses largely attributed to Circularity Scotland. Can I ask what lessons the government have learned about the influence of government policy on bank decision making? When we had Willie Watts in front of the committee before recess, he did say the bank would be reflecting on the process that was undertaken to give out this loan.
First Minister.
So there's a number of things to unpack, I think, in that question. First of all, having met Willie Watt, having met the Chief Executive, Al Denham, of the Scottish National Investment Bank, I think they're doing a very good job. I think they're it's not unexpected that they would, this phase of the bank's life cycle, that there would necessarily be a level of loss. I don't think it's completely unexpected, given that, of course, the Scottish National Investment Bank, one of the things it's tasked with doing is de-risking investment, particularly when it comes to net zero, particularly when it comes to new and innovative technologies. When I speak to business time and time and time again, they talk about helping to de-risk their investments and a greater appetite to share risk. And I think that's right, particularly when it comes to new technologies. So that's got to be a calculated risk. It can't just be cavalier, and I believe it is a calculated risk that is taken by the Scottish National Investment Bank. And Scottish Government, of course, has to allow the Scottish National Investment Bank to use its expertise to decide where to invest the funding it has. And of course, they've done a good job in leveraging in significant private investment in that regard. In terms of lessons learnt in relation to the deposit return scheme and Circularity Scotland, there are a number of lessons undoubtedly to learn, and I'm happy to give a very detailed written correspondence to Claire Baker. But what I would say is that it's a source of great frustration. I mean, I won't go over all of the history of where we are with the deposit return scheme and where we've ended up. But again, the Prime Minister's most recent announcements give me little hope at all that there will be a UK-aligned scheme by the time that the UK government had suggested there would be in 2025. So we've had our own scheme virtually torpedoed, and no UK scheme, I don't think, in sight. So I think it was right that SNIB invested, and it was a decision, obviously, for them to invest in Circularity Scotland at the time. I'm just frustrated that we have ended up in the position that we are in and unable to take forward a Scotland-only scheme that was ready to go and would have, I think, been very helpful in relation to reducing litter on our streets.
Thank you. The committee will be following up these questions with SNIB ourselves. The other issue in relation to SNIB was the legislation that established the bank. It was very clear in its expectations around gender inequality in the financial sector, and the government do have a number of commitments around women in enterprise. In the discussions you've had with the chairman and with the bank, do you make it clear the expectations from government and from parliament that they will be addressing gender inequality and supporting women within businesses, and they will be recognising the range of businesses that women in particular are invested in.
Yes, and those discussions, that will be reiterated in most of the discussions that we have with the Scottish National Investment Bank, but also with other stakeholders as well. I was in a meeting with representatives of the financial sector as part of our FISGAD group that we have. I'm pleased to say, of course, there was a number of women from the financial sector industry there represented, but more importantly, an agreement by that group that there's more work to be done in this regard. And of course, I know Claire Baker will know about Anna Stewart's excellent work that she has done on women in entrepreneurship. We are very committed to taking forward the recommendations in Anna Stewart's excellent piece of work. And we have made some considerable progress when it comes to the support that we're offering, able to offer women in entrepreneurship into work. And it's why a key commitment of my programme for government was to ensure that we expand our childcare offer, because although that helps families in the round, we know it disproportionately impacts in a positive way women and women's ability to get back into the workforce, which is good for women, good for families, good for the economy as well.
Is there time for another question?
Briefly, yes.
Briefly, just about the Fair Work sectoral agreements. So the mandate letter to Neil Gray did highlight the Fair Work sectoral agreements. Just appreciate an update on where we are with those, maybe particularly retail, as we did an inquiry into town centres.
Yeah, again, I'd probably be better writing to the member in more of the detail, but that's exactly why I found it important to raise that issue explicitly within the mandate letters, which is, of course, a new. It's an innovation that I've brought forward in order to ensure that all of the cabinet secretaries in my government are focused in terms of delivery. I do know about the town centre inquiry that has been done, and the report, of course, that you published at the end of last year. And we're very much keen to continue to work with COSLA around the town centre action plan and solidify multi-year funding, long-term funding for town centre regeneration in Scotland. So I'm happy to write to the member with more detail around some of the specifics that she asks in that regard.
Thank you
very much. Sticking with the economy theme, I'm going to invite back in Kenneth Gibbs. Okay.
Thank you very much, Convener. Funding public services requires a thriving and growing economy. So what is the Scottish Government's long-term economic growth strategy to deliver fiscal sustainability in light of the huge demographic challenges we face and a fiscal gap of around £1 billion, as highlighted by the Scottish Fiscal Commission?
We could spend hours answering that question. I won't, of course, as I can see, as we don't have time. And again, if there's anything that Kenneth Gibson wishes in terms of specifics to follow on, we'll always be happy to provide further detail. And I know Kenneth Gibson is very familiar with NSET, our National Strategy for Economic Transformation. That's at the very heart of our economic growth strategy. I was very clear in the programme for government. It was both an anti-poverty and pro-growth programme for government. There's a number of areas that we will look to invest in. Scotland, I believe its economic growth will be powered by our net zero opportunity. It's an incredible opportunity in relation to renewables, but we are blessed as a country with a number of sectors of great abundance. Our food and drink offer, we know whisky exports, for example, for the first time broke through the £6 billion barrier. We know our life sciences sector is growing, our space sector booming. A number of industries in Scotland, agriculture, hospitality, tourism, are great avenues, great opportunities to continue along our path in relation to economic growth. Kenneth Gibson is absolutely right to make mention of the demographic challenges, and it's a source of a great worry and concern. If there was something that gave me endless sleepless nights, it's that demographic challenge and workforce challenge that we're facing. I think every single sector I talk to, both public and private sector, share with me concerns around that demographic challenge. So what are we doing to try to resolve it? A few things. I would commend the detail of James Withers' review in relation to skills. The government is, of course, seeking to ensure that we take forward a number of the recommendations in James Withers' review in relation to skills, because that is clearly going to be important for us to understand the workforce of the present and the future and how we fill those gaps that clearly exist. We'll continue in relation to trying to attract talent from across the UK, and our talent migration attraction service will be important to that. And although we obviously don't have the powers over migration, we'll do what we can to ensure that Scotland is an attractive place as possible, and work with others to put forward sensible propositions to the UK government around how their migration how their migration policies can better suit our needs. And the very last thing I would say is there's areas, when it comes to depopulation, there's areas and parts of the country where we have a real concern, remote rural island communities, and that's why we're, for example, producing a variety of different plans to tackle those depopulation issues, and housing very much at the heart of those plans.
Yeah, thanks very much. I mean, it's obviously a huge area. I mean, clearly a focus on skills, innovation, startups and research and development would certainly be of assistance. But I want to move on to my second question, which is on taxation. And the Finance Committee heard in a pre-budget 24-25 evidence that both the United Kingdom and Scottish tax systems are complex and disjointed, with no clear progressivity in either. For example, the marginal rate of tax due to the interaction of income tax and national insurance, and of course national insurance is not devolved, is actually higher in Scotland for someone earning £44,000 a year than someone earning £54,000. So what is the Scottish Government's long-term taxation policy to provide certainty for taxpayers, progressivity, and ensure that potential investors and our public services can see into the future as to what their taxation policy is likely to be, and therefore how it will impact upon them?
First Minister.
So again, there's so much to unpack in that question from Kenneth Gibson. I suppose I would start by saying I'm not convinced, or certainly don't agree, that we haven't shown progressivity. I think we have a progressive tax system in Scotland. I'm very proud of that progressive tax system. Of course, we have to be mindful of national insurance contributions, and frankly, we also have to be very mindful of what decisions the UK government makes in relation to taxation. We're very alive and alert to the divergence which exists, and I don't have an issue with that divergence, because it certainly demonstrates our progressive taxation system. But we have to be mindful, because of course if it gets to a certain point there could be behavioural impacts that could be to our detriment, and we ensure that there's appropriate analysis and modelling done in that regard. But I don't flinch away from or shy away from the values of our taxation system, which essentially boils down to those who earn the most should pay the most. That's not something that I'm scared of unashamedly and explicitly putting on the record time again. So we will, and we do believe in a progressive tax system. I believe it was the IFS that said, due to our tax and changes that we've made in relation to Social Security, that those households in the 30% lowest income households with a child are better off to the tune of about £2,000. That's testament to the decisions that we've made, both in terms of taxation and also in terms of Social Security. In terms of the question of how do you give certainty over the longer term, it's a very reasonable question for Kenneth Gibson, of course, to ask. It is a difficult one to answer because, as Kenneth Gibson has already said in his question, some of the factors which influence what we will do with taxation don't lie with us. National insurance, you mentioned. Of course, the UK government's own tax policy. If they choose to, as they did with Liz Truss's mini budget, cut tax for the wealthy, then we have to be understanding and mindful of that. It doesn't mean we'll change course. Of course, we didn't change course during the mini budget. We're right not to change course during the disastrous mini budget. But of course, we have to be mindful of what the UK government does in that regard. But our central Our central driving ethos will be a progressive tax system so we can invest in our public services. And the Scottish Fiscal Commission, of course, do say that because of the taxation policies we brought forward, we have in around about £1 billion to spend and invest in our public services.
Okay. Apologies, I'm going to have to move on. Move on to the issue of Constitution, and I call Claire Adamson, Convener, Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. Claire.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, First Minister. The programme for government includes an ongoing policy commitment to align with EU law. Previously, this was qualified as appropriate, but is now qualified as being where possible and meaningful. The scale of this task is very familiar to everyone sitting around this table today, and our committee has published an EU tracker that will help committees in their scrutiny process. But can you confirm that the policy commitment as set out in the Continuity Act statement of policy is that Scottish ministers' default position is to align with EU law, and how will the Scottish Government support the committees in scrutinising these decisions?
First Minister.
I mean, that is absolutely the policy position around alignment where we can and where is possible. We have to also be upfront, and I think we have been, around where the limitations are in that regard. But we absolutely wish to continue alignment as far as we possibly can. In terms of transparency, I'm happy to continue to liaise with Claire Adamson, our committee, if there's anything further we can do in our own transparency of alignment. But in my recent visit to Brussels, I made it very clear to every single EU official that I spoke to that we want to continue that alignment so that when the day that Scotland does rejoin the European Union, that should help with that application process. I also think it's the right thing to do because of the high standards the EU often applied to a number of areas. So I don't want to see us moving back from that one single bit, but I'm more than happy to continue our discussion with with the committee if there's anything further we can do in around being more transparent around that particular piece of work.
Cliff, thanks very much. Okay, we now move on to a broader theme under the heading children. I'm going to invite CoCab Stewart, Convener, Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. CoCab.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, First Minister. The new UNCRC rights will only apply to Acts of the Scottish Parliament and not to Westminster legislation or any amendments that Holyrood has made since. This will obviously put out of scope key acts, including the Children's Scotland Act of 1995, Education Scotland Act as well. So what does this mean practically for children in Scotland in terms of the UNCRC bill?
Well, I suppose practically it means that we won't be able to give them the full range of coverage that we would have hoped to have done so with the incorporation of UNCRC. There will be many existing acts of the UK Parliament in areas, devolved areas that impact on children rights that will not be subject to the compatibility duty in this bill. And of course we had to have made the amendments to the legislation in a way that addressed the findings of the UK Supreme Court and try to reduce so far as possible the risk of any further legal intervention from the UK government, and at the same time create legislation that is coherent. In terms of the practical implication of the adjustment of the scope of the duty, I suppose that will become clearer over time once the bill has actually passed and the duty itself commences. So from a Scottish government perspective, we'll continue to do what we can, consider ways that we can support children, young people and their representatives to understand the new laws and consider what can be done within that legal framework to increase its scope in the future.
Thank you, First Minister. So, yes, I suppose looking at the duties of the scope on duty bearers and the implications and rights holders around that. But what work is the Scottish Government undertaking to consider how these changes to the UNCRC Bill will have to be drafted into the Scottish Human Rights Bill? And again, what will this mean in practice for the people of Scotland?
Well, that's very fair. Question indeed. We're obviously very mindful of the judgment from the courts and what implication that would have for the Scottish Human Rights Bill, which I have to say, speaking to very eminent individuals like Professor Alan Miller, as I did a couple of weeks ago, there is great global interest in Scotland's Human Rights Bill, but practically, of course, we will have to consider what the scope of that is. The duties that are currently proposed for that bill, they are different in nature to the compatibility duty in the UNCRC bill. They involve both procedural duties but also compliance duties. So we will have to think carefully about the implications, bearing in mind the nature of those duties. And the last thing I think any of us want is to go through the bill process only for there to be another legal challenge and risk having to go through a reconsideration phase and process once again. So I'm happy to keep the member. I'm certain the committee will be closely scrutinising the bill and happy to continue to liaise with her on these matters. But it's fair to say we have to consider the court judgment when it comes to what we're doing in relation to the Scottish Human Rights Bill.
Thank you. Thank you, First Minister.
Thank you. I'm now going to Sue Weber, Convener, Education, Children and Young People Committee. Sue.
Good morning. Good afternoon, rather, First Minister. As you're aware, our committee has taken a great deal of interest in behaviour in schools and has written to the Cabinet Secretary on the matter in advance of the first summit which took place earlier this month. Relationships and wellbeing in our schools is something which is vitally important to our committee. And whilst we appreciate that there are summits being held, can I ask what support the Scottish Government intends to give teachers in the meantime to address the behavioural issues in our schools?
First Minister.
Well, I'm thankful for the work that the committee has done in this regard and to the convener for the interest that she has shown. And she is right that the Cabinet Secretary for Education has, of course, continued to take these issues up. We are liaising as per the Verity House Agreement, we're liaising with our colleagues in local government to see what more we can do to support teachers and staff in relation to some of the concerning behaviour that we have seen. Sue Weber will also be aware that there is concern about what the impact of the pandemic potentially on children and what that might have done in relation to behaviour. So we're very keen to understand what is behind, what's the reasons that we're seeing really difficult behaviours that have been the focus of political attention, media attention and press attention. The other thing we're very, very keen to do is ensure that there is the appropriate counselling available, pre-crisis interventions accessible to every single secondary school in the country. So we'll continue to fund those interventions to understand the anxieties, concerns of our young people, which again I hope will help in relation to behaviours. But the reason for the summit was to bring a whole range of stakeholders, including political representatives, to see what more we could possibly do. So there is detailed consideration being given in that regard.
Thank you. I've got another question on a slightly different topic, First Minister. It's on the promise. So what will the Cabinet Secretary on the promise announced in the programme for government be looking at? When will it meet and who will be involved in it? And what, there's a lot of questions there, apologies. And what does the First Minister hope to see this group achieve? And the promise bill, when can we likely expect that?
First Minister.
So a number of things, you're right, in that question. We haven't finally determined the absolute membership of the subcommittee on keeping the promise. But the entire purpose, of course, of that subcommittee is to ensure that we have all of the appropriate ministers, cabinet secretaries and officials around that table, cross-government focus on not just keeping the promise, but delivering the promise to, in relation to what will its kind of overarching aim be. In that regard, the overarching aim will be to make sure that we keep the promise. That is a commitment that we have made. Sue Weber is very aware of the challenge that the Oversight Board presented to the government, and we have to make sure we're back on track to meet that commitment. In relation to the interim commitments, but also in relation to 2030. We will, of course, as a subcommittee, take advice from, for example, the independent advisor Fiona Duncan, in relation to the promise. I don't have detail of when the bill will be ready to bring forward. That's still work very much underway, but I'm more than happy to furnish Sue Webber with more detail, not just on legislation, but on the detail of the subcommittee once we have it underway. I should say the work on the promise doesn't rely on the subcommittee be put together. We're making progress in relation to the promise. And we have, if we do take a step back, there is, of course, there is noticeable progress that has been made in relation to the promise. Fewer young people in care, for example, within the care system, and that's something we want to build upon. So we won't wait for the subcommittee to necessarily take that action, but the subcommittee will bring a cross-government focus, which I hope will be welcomed by all.
Thank you.
Sticking with the children's theme, I'm going to invite back in Colette Stevens.
Thanks very much, Convener. First Minister, at our committee, we've just completed an inquiry into childcare and parental employment. So it was a welcome announcement within the programme for government, a number of measures aimed at tackling child poverty, including six local authorities to develop childcare from 9 months to end of primary school, pilots aimed at recruiting 1,000 child binders, and expanding eligibility of 2-year-olds for early learning in childcare. So do you feel that the childcare expansion is large enough and quick enough to have an impact on child poverty?
First Minister.
I think it's a really fair question. And I would say that, yes, I've got every confidence that not just the childcare expansion, but all of the all of the initiatives that we're bringing forward to try to tackle child poverty collectively will make a significant difference in relation to child poverty. We've seen, of course, from figures released in the last few months, that it's estimated through our work that 90,000 children will be lifted, are set to be lifted out of poverty this year. We're not complacent about that. We know there's more to do. We know that the very serious warnings from experts that we, the government needs to do more to remain on track in order to meet our child poverty targets. That's a challenge we take very, very seriously. So if I combine all of what we're doing in relation to tackling child poverty, I'm confident it's certainly moves us in the right direction. But it's why the budget that will, of course, be announced to this Parliament at the end of this year, I don't think I'm giving any surprises away when I say there will be a significant focus on reducing poverty and child poverty in particular, and that will require some difficult decisions to be made around issues, potentially around taxation, around targeting our resources in order to ensure we focus on those that need it the most.
Thanks so much, Colette. I'm going to move down the line to Audrey Nicol, Convener of the Criminal Justice Committee. Audrey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. My question follows on from the Chamber debate that the Criminal Justice Committee led last week on tackling online child sexual exploitation. Stakeholders have described how the threat, complexity and severity of offending continues to grow, and that tackling this issue goes beyond just one of law enforcement. And this week, a 3-day international conference is taking place here in Edinburgh to consider the global prevalence of child sexual exploitation. While taking evidence, the Criminal Justice Committee heard calls for the development of a sexual harm strategy for Scotland. However, to date, that has not been completed. Given the cross-cutting and complex nature of this issue, would the First Minister give further consideration to the development of an overarching sexual harm strategy, as highlighted by stakeholders who are working in this very complex space?
I will absolutely give consideration of that. I know this is an issue of great interest and worry to members right across the chamber, regardless of whether you're a parent or not. And I can't think of anything worse as a parent than my child being exploited in that way. I know that, of course, the Minister, in relation to the debate that took place last week, gave detail of our multifaceted approach in relation to tackling child exploitation and child sexual abuse. We absolutely agree that there's a complex issue cross-cutting nature of evolving issues requires a very strategic and coordinated approach. I'm also very keen to work with the UK government on this issue where we can. I think the UK government and Scottish government have worked well on issues such as human trafficking in the past. I'm happy to explore what more we can do on that and in that regard. In August, we did advise stakeholders, as I think the member will be aware, of our intention to establish a new strategic advisory group to review and further develop our approach to preventing and tackling all forms of child sexual abuse and exploitation, including, and I know Audrey Nicholl is very aware of this point, including, of course, online exploitation and abuse. So this group will consider whether a national strategy would help to underpin and strengthen work already underway. So in short, we'll absolutely give that consideration.
Thank you, First Minister.
Thanks. Thanks. Right, we're going to move on to broadly under the environment theme. I'm going to invite Finlay Carson, Convener, Rural Affairs and Islands Committee.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, First Minister. Can I ask how the Scottish Government will achieve its vision for agriculture through the much anticipated Agriculture Bill?
I think it is much anticipated, and what we're very keen to do with that bill is ensure that we work alongside our agricultural community to provide a level of stability. And look, I'm not going to get into all the kind of arguments in around Brexit or not, but one thing, of course, I think we can probably all agree on is that being part of the EU scheme when we were members of the European Union allowed a level of certainty around longer term funding which we just don't have at the moment. So we'll look to see how the bill can provide a level of stability around longer term funding which will be really important to our agricultural community. The second area which is of great importance, I know, to our farmers and to those involved in agricultural industries is ensuring that we create a sustainable future for farming in particular. And therefore, from 2025 in particular, how do we use the subsidies, the payments that are made, how do we use those in order to further our collective net zero aims and net zero ambitions? And I think we can do that in a way that is phased and in a way that, as I say, is done in conjunction with, as opposed to simply imposed upon farmers and those in our agricultural industries. Finlay Carson is right to say it's much anticipated and allude to the fact that it should be introduced imminently, and it will be introduced imminently. We had a further discussion about the Agriculture Bill at Cabinet just this week, so that bill will come forward imminently.
Thank you. I think a lot of the agricultural sector will take exception to the word subsidy. I hope we're moving away from there and it's support for food production. But Given the funding, you touched on funding, and currently there's a unique situation that exists with regards to ring fencing funding that comes from the UK government, and we've had that guaranteed for the last 7 years, specifically for agriculture. So what thought is the Scottish Government given to introducing multi-year funding, such as that the Welsh Government has done, to protect agricultural funding, particularly given the significant role that agriculture is currently playing, but more importantly, will play in delivering food security, climate change and enhancing biodiversity?
So, very favourable to looking at what certainty we can give to multi-year funding. I think it's necessary, I think it's required, I think it gives the sector a level of stability and certainty, which, as I say, I'm not entirely convinced they would say that has been given to them since our exit from the European Union. So it's absolutely important, and it's absolutely an issue of consideration as we bring forward the bill.
Thanks, Finlay. Right, we're going to move on to the health theme now, and I'm going to invite Claire Hawkey, Convener, Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Claire.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, First Minister. The Health, Social Care and Sport Committee recently took evidence on the NHS and social care winter planning, and the importance of the adult social care workforce in winter planning was quite rightly emphasised by many stakeholders, by officials and the Cabinet Secretary, and the recruitment and retention of the social care workforce was raised in both written and oral evidence. So can the First Minister advise what work needs to be undertaken to support the implementation of the commitment to a pay uplift for the adult social care workforce as outlined in the programme for government, and how it's anticipated that this will benefit the workforce in the sector?
First Minister.
So again, this is an issue of great complexity and one that if the convener, if Claire Hawkey wishes, she can come back to me if there's further detail that she wishes, because in the interest of brevity, I'll try to cover just the key salient points. Pay is absolutely an issue. So everybody we talk to in social care will tell us that they are in a very competitive labour market. They will often be losing people out, losing people from social care and adult social care in particular, to a whole host of sectors, from retail to the NHS to many other sectors. And that's why it was important for me in the programme for government to be able to signal that from April next year, we will give a significant pay uplift. That comes in the back of the fact that we've already seen an increase to a minimum of £10.90 per hour from April of this year, in line with the real living wage rate. And that minimum pay represents an almost 15% increase for those workers in the last 2 years. But also, let me be absolutely honest, I've heard from the sector too that they feel that that pay uplift should have been made today, should have been made at the time of the Programme for Government announcement. And I wish we could have done that. But given the significant financial pressures that we are under, that just is not possible. But I completely understand why the sector would want us to make that investment now. So I do hear the sector in terms of some of their frustrations and even disappointment that that uplift hasn't happened immediately. The other issue I would point to is terms and conditions. So pay is, of course, important. I think it's probably the number one factor. But I think terms and conditions are important. So we do have, as I think Claire Hawkey is aware of, a group looking at fair work within social care. And there are some further actions that we can take in relation to fair work and social care, which I think are really important. And career progression, hugely important as well. And that's why I'm absolutely committed to the National Care Service. It's not the panacea to all of the issues that we face in social care, but it will greatly help in terms of pay, terms and conditions, sectoral bargaining, ethical commissioning. I think all of these issues will help in relation to have a really thriving social care sector, and one that is absolutely vital. You know, social care is important in its absolutely its own right, but we know it's important also in order to help us with an NHS recovery as well.
Yeah.
Thank the First Minister for that answer. I'm going to move on to another subject, if I may. So the Joint Committee on Tackling Drug Deaths and Drug Harm met yesterday, and there was, as you can imagine, there was a great deal of discussion about the establishment of a safe consumption facility pilot, which I believe was approved this morning by authorities in Glasgow. Unfortunately, the Minister was unwell and unable to answer questions yesterday. So can I ask the First Minister if he can provide an update on plans for the Glasgow City facility, what community engagement and consultation will be done both before and during the pilot process, and importantly, this was raised with the committee yesterday, how the Scottish Government will ensure those with lived and living experience will be included in the development and the evaluation of the pilot.
First Minister.
Can I thank Claire Hawkey for an exceptionally important question. I've seen the news today that Glasgow has approved a safer drug consumption facility. It's a decision I very much welcome. I also welcome the Lord Advocate's most recent statement in relation to prosecution policy in this regard as well. So I'm very grateful to Glasgow for moving at pace. And let me say unequivocally that the Scottish Government is ready to stand alongside Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership and our colleagues within local government to advance this proposition as quickly as we possibly can, obviously within the confines of the pilot that was proposed and receive that statement of prosecution policy from the Lord Advocate. And that extends to, for example, how we can provide funding support for that safer drug consumption facility. It will be for Glasgow to take forward, and I have no doubt in the discussions that we as a government have had with Glasgow thus far, they are very mindful of taking the community alongside us and alongside them, and also in taking forward the views of those with lived experience. And I think it's appropriate for me to pay tribute to the likes of Peter Kraken and others who have spoken about their own experience in this regard and have frankly pushed us all to take more actions in the face of an unacceptable drug death crisis. While I was in New York, primarily for Climate Week, I did take some time to speak to the New York State Commissioner for Health, for the Department of Health, Dr. Aswan, and he had mentioned to me that their experience of having safer drug consumption facilities in New York for the last 18 months, I believe, was that it was imperative to try to take the public with you as best you possibly could. And the second point he made, which is one that I know Glasgow are absolutely committed to, that it isn't just about the safer drug facility, consumption facility, it's also about all the services that are co-located and wrapped around that. I believe that New York are going to be publishing some data from the first 18 months of the safer drug consumption facility, and that's been promised to be shared with us and the Scottish Government, and I'm sure we can then share with Glasgow. But it certainly it seems to have been a helpful and positive experience in New York as being one tool as part of a wider effort to reduce drug deaths.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think we're going to stick with this theme. I'm going to move it over and invite back in Audrey Nicholl. Audrey.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, indeed, I am going to stay with this theme, and I would follow up from the comments that and the question that Claire Hawhey asked around the Lord Advocate's recent statement and obviously the news today in relation to safe consumption rooms. But also I'd like to ask about wider questions that this has raised regarding support for people using such a facility, with particular regard to their continued contact with organised crime to source their drug of use. There is consensus, obviously, that a public health approach is the right approach in Scotland. However, I wonder if the First Minister can outline how the Scottish Government might take account of this issue within the Safe Consumption Room pilot in such a way that provides a holistic response that in time might support the elimination of the need for individuals to maintain links with organised crime in supplying their drug of use. And I'm interested in the comments that the First Minister made about the work in New York.
First Minister.
Well, it's such an exceptionally important question, really good question to ask. I don't have the Lord Advocate's statement in front of me, but certainly from memory, the Lord Advocate was very precise and focused in the language that she used. And of course, she mentioned that it would not be in the public interest to prosecute for simple possession offences taking place in the pilot, and that is quite a narrowly defined pilot in Glasgow in relation to safer drug consumption facilities. Making it clear, well, the Advocate made it clear that doesn't impact on prosecution out with that quite narrow definition. So the work, which I know Audrey Nicholl is very familiar with in relation to the Serious Organised Crime Task Force, that work absolutely will continue in relation to those criminal gangs who seek to exploit people's vulnerabilities and look to profit from the misery of others and the misery of communities. So that work will continue, I would suggest, unaffected by the statement of prosecution policy from the Lord Advocate. So we do take a public health approach when it comes to the issue of drunk deaths, but we know that Police Scotland and credit goes to Police Scotland, that their focus on tackling serious organised crime has reaped many rewards in terms of breaking up some of those criminal gangs, but there is a significant amount of work still to do. I also just go back to the point I made a moment ago to Claire Hawkey, that the safer drug consumption facilities in their own can of course be helpful, but the real value comes in having access to other services. And that was a really strong message from the Commissioner in New York.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Audrey. Right, I'm now going to invite Stuart McMillan, Convener of Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, to take over the next questions. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. First Minister, you announced a bill on judicial factors in the programme for government, which is based on a Scottish Law Commission report and which we believe is likely to be a strong candidate to actually come to the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Can you set out what benefits you believe this bill is actually going to bring about?
For the judicial factors bill, I've been aware of for a number of years now. First and foremost, before I go into judicial factors, I think it's important to say I think we've got to a better position when it comes to Scottish Law Commission bills. I think there was a concern about the flow coming from Scottish Law Commission through to actual legislation being passed by this Parliament. So I think we are in a better place. This will be the third SLC bill to be introduced to this Parliament this session. In terms of judicial factors, the issue around judicial factors is not a new one. It's got a long history in Scottish law, and there's a continuing need for capable, knowledgeable, expert administrators to be appointed to manage the property of those who can't, should not or will not manage it properly themselves. But the current law, as we know, is outdated. I think it would be fair to say it's over a century old, with no new primary legislation specifically on judicial factors since 1889. So the bill will aim to introduce a statutory framework which sets out clearly the essential features of the Office of Judicial Factor and the broad parameters within which it should operate, and it will be, I think, of benefit to all those involved in judicial factories in whatever capacity. So the Scottish Law Commission consulted on this issue, made a number of recommendations which the Scottish Government tested in a further consultation, and as I say, we're committed to bringing forward that, that bill this year.
Thank you for that, First Minister. Just on the theme of the SLC bills, I mean, you're quite correct in terms of this is the third bill when this does come into the Parliament. Hopefully it does come to the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. And obviously progress has been made, but can you give an assurance to this committee today that the Scottish Government will continue on that theme of bringing forward more SLC bills?
Yes, simply I can. I think it's we've got into a better rhythm of doing that over the years, especially since changes were made in 2013. This would be the eighth bill to be introduced. Sorry, there's already been eight bills introduced since those rules were updated in 2013. And you'll know that the government is considering a number of other SLC reports during this session, as were set out by not my programme for government, my predecessor's programme for government. In 21-22, so yes, I think we're in a better place in that regard, and we continue to look forward to continue working closely with the SLC and of course with the appropriate committee in this regard.
Thank you. Sure. I'm now going to move on and invite Jackson Carlow, convener of the Citizens Participation in Public Petitions Committee. Jackson.
First Minister, as convener of this particular committee, it affords me the opportunity to bring directly to you the aims of a particular petition, and hopefully to banjax you into agreeing with the petitioner's ambitions, and I do that again today. I acknowledge the statement this morning in relation to ongoing support for asylum seekers, but we heard a petition number 2028, from Pina Aksu and Doa Abu Amar, who are both, I think, aware that I'm raising this with you today, on concessionary bus travel for asylum seekers. Now, at the moment, of the 6,000 asylum seekers, roughly a third are probably able to claim because they're either under 22 or they're over 60. But it leaves about 4,000 people who are not. Now, I understand the difficulty when it comes to benefits, but this is a concessionary scheme, and Spice think it's entirely within the competence of the Scottish Government to extend free concessionary travel to this group. It was within the 22-23 programme for government, a specific reference to delivering a system, a scheme whereby free concessionary travel would be available. It's not in the current programme for government. But we've obviously heard from MSPs and from the community themselves who believe that an extension of this kind would be enormously valuable to asylum seekers and their ability to live and operate within the community. And Paul Sweeney brought to the committee last week an example of one asylum seeker who required dental treatment, couldn't afford the bus fare, had to walk 10 miles in the rain and in pain to secure the treatment that was otherwise available for him. I don't want to throw figures around. It's been suggested it would be about £500,000. I don't know whether that's correct or not. But bluntly, I suppose, is this an objective that the First Minister might like to commit to being able to deliver?
it's taken over an hour for the first banjaxing. First Minister.
And if there's one issue that I should be banjaxed into, I think this is probably a contender for an issue that I absolutely should give consideration to. We are actually actively giving consideration to this very, very issue. Can I commend the petitioners as well? I know Pienaar in particular over a number of years has been a vocal advocate for the rights of asylum seekers. Can I also say that Jackson Carlow's question is particularly welcome on the back of some dreadful commentary around refugees that we saw in the last 24 hours from the UK government. And I know Jackson Carlow has been often on the right side of issues in relation to asylum and refugees for a number of years, and kind of recognise that. Look, in short, we are open, and not only open to this issue, we are giving it active consideration. There are a number of complex challenges when it comes to, in particular, what we are able to do in relation to asylum seekers, how they are identified, how we can make a concessionary scheme work, but these are not insurmountable if there is a desire to take forward these issues. So I can't say anything more other than it's been an issue of live discussion from within government, and if there is a way to do this, then I'm seeking government's then we are certainly seeking to do that, but it does come with some complexities which I'm certain Jackson Carlow will be aware of.
You're on a roll, Jackson. Do you want any more?
Took that as a yes.
Great. We'll move on now to Claire Adamson, who I think has got some questions in relation to culture policy.
Thank you, Convener. First Minister, if I could turn to the culture remit of our committee. In your mandate letter to the Cabinet Secretary, you state that Mr Robertson should collaborate with ministerial colleagues across government to mainstream culture into policy making. This is an aspiration and ambition that's been around for a long time, almost back to Christie, and one that not least, most recently, the published Culture and Communities report from the committee has touched on as well. So do you agree that we need to see real progress in this area to truly meet the ambitions and cross-portfolio funding for culture? And how do you see your role as First Minister in leading in this area to ensure that we meet the ambitions of a well-being society and a well-being economy?
First Minister.
I'm really grateful to Claire Adamson for asking the question. And I go back to my point around the mandate letters, which has not been done before. And I know it can seem quite almost an anarchy point to make within policy development and delivery, but I think it is really important that it's understood the reason for the mandate letters is to drive forward a real focus on delivery. And so each Cabinet Secretary is in no doubt whatsoever, and it's been done in collaboration with Cabinet Secretaries, but there's no doubt whatsoever about what the expectation, my expectation, and I believe now the public's expectation will be on what they deliver between now and 2026. And mainstreaming culture has got to be a part of that. And what I've asked Angus Robertson to do is consider what structures need to be put in place with fellow cabinet secretaries and ministers in order to understand that they equally understand the importance of mainstreaming culture within their portfolio. So Angus Robertson, has, in the first instance, has taken forward a number of bilaterals. I think with if not all, the vast majority of cabinet secretaries around that very issue of mainstreaming culture. And you know, I can say from my previous, most recent experiences, health secretary, there is huge amounts of synergy between what we're looking to do in relation to better health outcomes and in relation to culture. You know, think about social prescribing as one example of that. And in cabinet, On Tuesday, we had a post-cabinet discussion on child poverty, and of course culture was a significant part of that discussion, given of course the excellent work that a number of cultural organisations such as Sistema do in relation to child poverty. So I can give Claire Adamson absolute assurance that this has been taken forward by Angus Robertson. He has my full support in taking forward these discussions with Cabinet colleagues, and it's now a case of putting in place the appropriate structures to make sure that that is understood and delivered upon.
Thank you, First Minister.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to move on to housing-related issues. I'm going to call back in Ariane Burgess. Ariane.
Thanks very much.
Programme for Government sets out the intention to introduce a housing bill, which will, amongst other things, make provisions for long-term rent controls. The emergency measures set out in last year's Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act will have expired before these long-term measures can take effect. Both tenants and landlords need certainty about what will happen in this interim period as a matter of urgency. And the committee has had assurance, has been assured that there will be transitional provisions in place. But we would welcome the First Minister's reassurances that this clarity for tenants and landlords will be coming imminently.
Yes, it will be. It's an important point that Ariane Burgess raises around the need for transitional arrangements. And you know, the fear, of course, is when these current provisions expire, then there's a significant steep increase in rents, and that is something that I know worries a number of private renters in particular. And the committee did hear from the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights just a couple of weeks ago. And we are very much looking at options for the effective use of the regulation-making powers in Schedule 3 of the Cost of Living Act to temporarily reform the current rent adjudication process. That regulation-making power, of course, will be subject to the approval of Parliament, and it will be crucial in allowing us to temporarily alter the rent adjudication process to prevent unintended consequences as we transition out of the emergency measures of the Act. Of course, continued discussions with stakeholders, including landlords, will be incredibly important, and we hope to be able to introduce proposals in, certainly in due course, shortly, in fact, after the current extension takes place. But I would just point again to the words of Patrick Harvey in this regard, that an adjustment to the rent adjudication process will prevent an immediate cliff edge when the temporary emergency legislation expires. And that is absolutely right and proper. Nobody wants that kind of cliff edge for anybody that is renting in Scotland.
Thank you.
And Colette Stevenson.
Thanks, Convener. First Minister, it'll be no surprise that I'm going to focus in again on child poverty and what more can be done to reduce the number of children living in temporary accommodation just now.
There is a significant amount of work for us to do in relation to children in temporary accommodation. Unfortunately, the latest statistics show the trajectory moving in the wrong direction. That's not acceptable. We've got to take our share of the responsibility in that regard, which we absolutely do. So Colette Stevenson, I know, will absolutely be aware of the work that we have done in relation to the temporary accommodation task and finish group. And we are committed, absolutely committed, without any exception, to act on the recommendations of that group. And that includes investing at least £60 million for councils and social landlords to acquire properties to use as social homes, asking social landlords to increase allocations to homeless households, and supporting councils facing the greatest temporary accommodation pressures to develop targeted plans. So we will not rest until we absolutely make progress in reducing significantly the use of temporary accommodation, because, as I say, I'm afraid the latest statistics show a worrying trend and a worrying number of families and children in temporary accommodation, and that's not acceptable.
Thanks, Colette. Right, just to give time for colleagues to think up any last questions they have, I'm going to invite Kenneth Gibson to ask.
Thank you very much for your indulgence, Convener. First Minister, Westminster, Holyrood, local government, health boards, community planning partnerships, joint integration boards, regional and city deals, 150 or so quangos, an increasing number of commissioners, as we'll see this very day, and a board to oversee the National Care Service. That's a lot for a country of 5.4 million people, so I'm just wondering what steps the Scottish Government will take to reform and declutter this very crowded public sector landscape.
First Minister.
So the member will be aware that the Deputy First Minister has responsibility for public sector reform. I think that is an important role for the Deputy First Minister to have, given she obviously has the finance brief, and that's deliberate. And I think we are very mindful of the fact that it can be quite a complex landscape for the public to navigate. So that work is being undertaken by the Deputy First Minister. She's involving all Cabinet Secretaries that are relevant and appropriate, and Ministers that are relevant and appropriate through regular meetings, cross-portfolio meetings that take place. So we recognise that there's a need to simplify and ensure that we are as efficient as possible, particularly in a challenging financial landscape. But I also make no apologies whatsoever for ensuring that at the heart of our principles is fair work and ensuring those in the public sector are paid well, paid fairly for the exceptional job they do right across the public sector.
Thanks.
Kenneth.
I was also going to ask on another topic, what discussions has the First Minister had with the UK Government over any guidance on the role of civil servants working in the devolved administrations regarding the delivery of manifesto commitments?
Minister.
Oh, well, I'm certain the member is aware of the various interventions from members of the House of Commons, members of the House of Lords, and even UK Government ministers, certainly alluding to the fact that the Scottish Government shouldn't be doing work that we have a mandate for, in particular in relation to the Constitution. We have, of course, since the Supreme Court judgment, have clear guidance from the Permanent Secretary around, of course, what work we can do. And, of course, I'll just quote from John Paul Marks, Permanent Secretary in the Finance and Public Administration Committee on the 16th of May of this year. We serve the government of the day. That includes with regards to constitutional reform. It's been well understood under devolution for many years that the civil service in the Scottish Government serves the Scottish Government and its priorities. And we provide policy advice, including the development of the prospectus paper series for the government to set out its constitutional objectives. So we know that our excellent civil service will work, of course, in an impartial, apolitical manner, but will provide assistance and support to the government of the day for the objectives that it has been elected, the mandate has been given, and the manifesto commitments that it has made. And there can be no doubt or dubiety about the fact that this, the party I lead, has a clear mandate for a referendum on independence, and that's something we'll continue to pursue.
Thank you. Thanks, Camille.
You won't be surprised to know that you've sparked late interest in further questions. I'm going to come first to Claire Adamson, then to Richard Leonard. Claire.
Thank you very much. My colleague Sue Weber raised the issue of behaviour in schools, and you touched on all the issues post-COVID and an understanding of all of this, but obviously educational reform is on the agenda of the government going forward. In the summer, I hosted, as part of the Festival of Politics, a quick Q&A session in the chamber with Gustavo Dudamel, and we had the El Sistema graduates from the number of years and all the El Sistema projects from across Scotland in the gallery, and to hear the inspirational transformation that that had made to these young people was simply inspiring. So can I ask the First Minister, how will you ensure that projects we know work that make a difference to young people will be embedded going forward as we look to reform some of these issues in our education system?
I think this goes to the heart of the work I've asked the Finance Secretary to do and the Cabinet to do more broadly, which is we know that the financial circumstances we find ourselves in are very challenging. I've been in government for 11 odd years, and I've never seen the finances, the public finances, as constrained and difficult and challenging. And that's not just the Scottish Government. One only has to look at the measures the Welsh Government have brought forward, for example, and I've got tremendously good relationships and constructive relationships with the Welsh Government. But the fact that they've, I think, put every health board into special measures around governance and finance, just as a demonstration of how difficult financial circumstances are right across devolved governments. So that is why I've asked the Cabinet and again the Deputy First Minister to spearhead the work around targeting, ensuring that our focus is that every penny we spend is going to those people who need it the most. Now, in order to do that, we have to make sure we have the requisite data that tells us what works, what interventions are significantly helping us in relation to the targets we've got in regards to poverty and child poverty in particular. And I do commend the programmes like Sistema. I've seen the big noise myself in Dundee during a visit to Claypots Castle Primary School not too long ago. So if I can give Claire Adamson an assurance, that piece of work is very much underway around what targeted interventions can help, what do we need to scale up, and it will also involve difficult decisions, and we'll get to that during the budget in relation to other things that we might not be able to do, or we might have to reprofile, and that will be a really difficult discussion to have, but we're not shying away from those difficult decisions, because they have to take place, as I say, given the really difficult financial circumstances we find ourselves in.
And Richard Leonard.
First Minister, last year the Scottish Government paid £30 million out to the consulting industry. That's more in that year than the previous 4 years put together. At least some of those consultancies insist on non-disclosure agreements, the Public Audit Committee discovered. Doesn't that prove one of your Council of Economic Advisers right when she says that the consulting industry is the big con, infertilising our governments, warping our economies, and significantly in the context of transparency, obfuscating political accountability?
So can I tell you where I disagree with that quote, is that where we can provide the expertise within government, we absolutely will seek to do that. There's always the default position. Where we need further expertise, using consultants is something that is done by governments, again, right across the UK, whether it's the Welsh Labour government, whether it's the Scottish government, UK government, of course, the government in Northern Ireland as well. And we will try to limit that spend where we can. £30 million is not an insignificant amount, I accept that. It is a fraction of our resource budget, it would be fair to say. So we try to limit where we can. I would need to look at the specific details of all of that spend in order to give an individual commentary on each amount that was spent. In terms of non-disclosure agreements, NDAs, we really, again, have a default position of not using them. Where NDAs are sometimes entered into is because of issues around commercial sensitivity. In relation to, for example, Ferguson's shipyard, and that is to protect the commercial interests of a particular entity so that it can be competitive in the marketplace, and if the NDA wasn't there, then that would potentially jeopardise that commercial sensitivity. But I think the points that Richard Leonard makes broadly are absolutely right, and government should be very aware and wary of the spend that they make in relation to consultants.
But in relation to that specific example, the NDA was insisted upon by the consultancy, not by Ferguson Marine.
But again, that may, from the detail I have seen, when it comes to the NDA that exists between Ferguson's Marine and the consultants involved, that was there to protect commercial sensitivity, and the concern is that it would work against the competitiveness of Ferguson's if that the report was published and published in full. So that's my understanding, certainly, of the position of the NDA between Ferguson's and the consultant. When it comes to any non-disclosure agreements we're involved in, it will be often when it is, for example, the sharing of sensitive material. But I take the point that Richard Leonard makes and that he quotes in that we should be as open and transparent about our use of consultants and the reports that they publish.
I've now got a couple of and finalies. I suspect Stuart's is on this issue. Is it? I'll come to Stuart first and then Colette, but they'll have to be brief.
Sure. Thanks, Stuart. No, thank you. It's not regarding DNAs, but certainly it's about the shipyard. First Minister, has the Scottish Government any nearer to taking a final decision regarding a direct award to Ferguson Shipyard?
It's still under consideration.
Thank you.
And Colette Stevenson.
Thanks very much, Convener and First Minister. You announced in the programme for government a number of measures aimed at tackling poverty, such as the removal of income thresholds from the Best Start Foods programme. But to address the root causes of poverty, interventions are clearly required at reserve level as well. Can you elaborate on how urgent an essentials guarantee from the UK Government to adequately cover the cost of essentials like food, transport and energy aligns with the Scottish Government's missions to reduce inequality and child poverty as well?
Given the time, I'm happy again to furnish Colette Stevenson if there's any further detail, points of detail that she wishes to receive. The essentials guarantee is an idea that's been brought forward by a number of anti-poverty organisations, Joseph Roundtree Foundation in particular, it's called on the UK Government, to immediately set the universal credit standard allowance at £120 per week for a single adult and £200 for a couple for 23-24. And doing so would have some very real impacts on the UK population, according to the foundation. Over 8 million families would see their incomes rise on average by £48 per week. Over half of working age families in the UK with a disabled family member would benefit, and almost 70% of people in poverty being able to pay for essentials, with 3 in 5 whom are already working families. So it's a significant intervention. It's why we add our weight to the voice. We add our weight to the voices that are calling for an essentials guarantee. But we also accept that it doesn't abdicate us of our responsibility in terms of the devolved powers that we have, and hence why we've used those devolved powers, social security powers, taxation powers, I believe, to move us into a positive direction in relation to tackling poverty and child poverty, in particular with the Scottish Child Payment perhaps being the most obvious and deliberate example of a game-changing intervention that can help and assist in relation to poverty here in Scotland.
OK, I'm going to wind it up there. Thank you very much indeed. That concludes the meeting. Can I thank very much the First Minister for his attendance, not least struggling through man flu, which I know from personal experience can be hugely debilitating. I hope we can reprise this in about 6 months' time, and we will be in touch with your office about scheduling a date for that, First Minister. But that concludes the meeting. The next meeting will be after the October recess on the 25th of October. So thank you all for your participation, and I close this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.